Hello students of class 8 and welcome to your online class. Today I'm going to continue with the story The Summit Within. The Summit Within deals with the story of Major Ahluwalia and he shares with us his experience of climbing Mount Everest and how he felt when he stood on the top of the mountain. So take out your main textbook and take out page number 77. Okay. So the last portion that we did was Major Ahluwalia was telling us why do people climb mountains. He believes or he came to the conclusion that maybe it is because of the eternal quest in a person, in humans, to do the impossible. Whatever seems difficult, whatever seems challenging, humans or we seem drawn towards it, right? And maybe because of that, since the mountains look to be a very difficult thing to climb, people climb it. But he had a more personal reason for climbing the mountain. What is the personal reason of Major Ahluwalia? We are going to find out. So take out page number 77. We are going to begin from the paragraph. I have a more personal answer to the question. From my childhood, I have been attracted by mountains. I had been miserable, lost, when away from mountains in the plains. Mountains are nature at its best. Their beauty and majesty pose a great challenge, and like many, I believe that mountains are a means of communion with God. So, mountains have been, that means Major Ahluwalia has always been attracted to mountains. He loved mountains even when he was a child. And whenever he was away from mountains, he felt miserable and lost. He also believed that mountains are nature's best creation and was also a means of communicating with God. Communion means a communication. That means whenever you are on top of the mountains or when you are climbing on the mountain, those isolated, majestic mountains, you do actually have a chance of communion with God. You can communicate with God. You can have a spiritual union with God. Once having granted this, the question remains, why Everest? That is, why did I choose to climb Mount Everest? Because it is the highest, the mightiest, and has defied many previous attempts. It takes the last ounce of one's energy. It is a brutal struggle with rock and ice. Once taken up, it cannot be given up halfway, even when one's life is at stake. The passage back is as difficult as the passage onwards. And then, when the summit is climbed, there is the exhilaration, the joy of having done something, the sense of a battle fought and won. There is a feeling of victory and of happiness. So why did I choose Mount Everest? Because it is the highest mountain in the world, because it is the most powerful, it seems to be the most powerful, mightiest means powerful. It looked and it has also defied. That means many people had tried to climb Everest before, but they have failed. And so it seemed to me that let me take up this challenge of climbing Mount Everest. And he also tells us that climbing the mountain takes up every ounce of one's energy. That means all bits of your energy is drained when you are climbing the mountain. Even when you are halfway the mountain, you cannot turn back because the journey back is also as difficult as the journey forward. Okay, so life is at stake at every point of climbing the mountain. And so, even though it is so difficult, there is also a joy of facing this challenge, the exhilaration that you have been able to survive through the entire process. Okay, that is what made him choose Mount Everest. Glimpsing a peak in the distance, I get transported to another world. That is, whenever I look at a mountain peak in the distance, I get transported to another world. For him, that world is the spiritual world. I experience a change within myself which can only be called mystical. The change which happens in himself whenever he looks at a mountain can only be called mystical, that is spiritual. By its beauty, aloofness, might, ruggedness and the difficulties encountered on the way, the peak draws me to it as Everest did. Because the peak, the mountain peak is so beautiful, it is so mighty, it is so aloof. Aloof means separate from others, as if The mountain does not get influenced by whatever happens around it. It has its own world. It stands isolated. It stands strong and proud of itself. So this, all these qualities of the mountains, and of course the difficulties which one person can encounter whenever they climb the mountain, also makes it very attractive to the man. It is a challenge that is difficult to resist. That is, this challenge which the mountain throws at me, it seems like I cannot resist that challenge. I have to take it up. Looking back, I find that I have not yet fully explained why I climbed Everest. It is like answering a question, why you breathe? Why do you help your neighbor? Why do you want to do good acts? There is no final answer possible. And then there is the fact that Everest is not just a physical climb. The man who has been to the mountaintop becomes conscious in a special manner of his own smallness in this large universe. So looking back, I find that I have not yet explained why I climbed Everest. It is like answering a question, some basic questions like why you breathe, why you help somebody, why you do something good. That means instinctively the goodness which is in us, or the things that we do just because we feel like doing them, things which make us survive, things which are as essential to our survival as breathing. Everest, climbing Mount Everest was similar to him. Okay, so of course there is the fact that Everest is not just a physical climb. That means your physical strength is obviously tested. You need to be very, very physically fit. But at the same time, the mental tenacity is also tested whenever you are climbing a mountain. And of course, a mountain like Mount Everest, when you are climbing that, you need the strength of your mind as much as the strength of your body. The man who has been to the mountaintop becomes conscious of his smallness in this entire universe. That means when a person climbs the top of the mountain, top of Mount Everest, that person feels very much conscious about how small he is or she is compared to the rest of the world. We are just very, very, very minute compared to, and very insignificant, okay, compared to the mighty nature, to the entire universe. Compared to the entire universe, we are really very insignificant. And this smallness of a person is understood when a person climbs the Mount Everest. The physical conquest of a mountain is only one part of the achievement. There is more to it than that. It is followed by a sense of fulfillment. That is, you feel very satisfied when you climb that mountain, as if you have done something which is mentally pleasing to you. There is the satisfaction of a deep urge to rise above one's surrounding, this instinctive urge in person to rise above the rest, to do what somebody else can't do. This urge within all humans, this exists within all of us, to be the best in something, okay, and to climb above others. For this man and for all the people who climbed Everest, this feeling is there. It is the eternal love for adventure in man. Of course, the adventurous spirit in a person is also tested while climbing a mountain. Okay, eternal love for adventure. The experience is not merely physical, it is emotional, it is spiritual. Consider a typical climb. So he gives us an example of what happens when they are climbing the mountain towards the summit on the last heights. That is, you are almost on the top of the mountain, but yet there is some distance left. And at that time, what does a person feel? You are sharing a rope with another climber. You firm in. That means you make the rope tight. He cuts the steps in the hard ice. Okay. That is, he cuts the steps in the hard ice and climbs. And you are sharing the rope with that person. So both of you have to adjust your speed so that none of you goes back. Okay. No, none of you, both of your speed should be matched. Okay. The climb is grim. The climb is very serious. Even one misstep can lead to the death of both of you because you are sharing the rope. You strain every nerve as you take every step. Famous climbers have left records of the help given to others. They have also recorded how they needed just that help. Famous climbers have left records. That means after climbing the mountain, after coming back from there, The climbers who climbed it, they always accept the gratitude. They always express their gratitude towards their fellow climbers who helped them climb, because it's not a one person job. Okay, not just a single person can do it on their own. They need the help of somebody. Mostly it is the company of many people. Together they go to the expedition, but you cannot do it on your own. Else they might have given up, because you need somebody to tell you that yes, you can do it. Do not give up at this moment. Somebody to encourage you all through the process. Breathing is difficult. Obviously, in that height, how can you expect to be breathing? They carry oxygen cylinders with them for that. You curse yourself for having let yourself in for this. And in those difficult moments, you sometimes curse yourself that why did I take up this difficult challenge? I shouldn't have. I should have simply stayed back at home. You wonder why you ever took the undertook the ascent. Why did you start climbing the mountain? Ascent means the climb to the top, towards up. There are moments when you feel like going back. Would be sheer relief to go. No, it would be sheer relief to go down instead of up. But almost at once, you snap out of that mood. Sometimes you feel like it should be like you should simply stop climbing anymore and you should go down. But at the very next moment, you change your decision. You snap out of that mood. That means you make yourself out of that mood. You tell yourself, do not think of going back. You have to complete the climb. There is something in you that does not let you give up the struggle, and you go on. Your companion keeps up with you just another 50 feet. So every time there is something in you, something instinctive in you that tells you that you cannot give up now. And your companion also helps you to go, to keep up. Along with your speed, that companion is also keeping up with your speed. If you are late, that person waits for you. If you are fast, that person tries to get to that speed. Okay. Or 100 maybe. You ask yourself, is there no end? That is, how much longer I have to go on climbing? You look at your companion and he looks at you. You draw inspiration from each other. Now you see, there's a picture given in this page, the author and Pu Dorji on the summit of Everest. You can see the dress that they're wearing. It's a suit, okay? It's a suit which they have to wear in that temperature and in that pressure point. The body is not suitable to take up. And they are also wearing glasses, as you can see, as well as an oxygen mask is attached with their nose, okay? And they are carrying a bag with them, which carries all the essential things that they will need. Looking round from the summit, you tell yourself that it was worthwhile. Other silvery peaks appear through the clouds. That means when he was on top of the summit, he felt that it's worthwhile. Taking so much risks, doing so much hard work, constantly challenging your nature, constantly challenging yourself to do more and more. All this has been worthwhile, because the beauty of nature which stretches before them is just unimaginable. The surrounding peaks look like a jeweled necklace around the neck of your summit. Below, you see vast valleys sloping into the distance. It is an ennobling, that means something which makes you noble. Okay, something which makes you feel better. Enriching experience to just look down from the summit of a mountain. You bow down and make your obeisance to, means you submit yourself before, or you pray before whatever god you worship. I left on Everest a picture of Guru Nanak. Rawat left a picture of Goddess Durga. Pu Dorji left a relic of the Buddha. Edmund Hillary had buried a cross under a cairn in the snow. So here, on top of the mountain, all the different religions, they unite, because all men and women realize that whatever god or whatever religion gives you strength, or it can be a person also who gives you strength, becomes very significant in these last moments, because you need to express your gratitude for being alive, for having the strength to keep up. I left the experience of having climbed to the summit changes you completely. There is another summit. It is within yourself. It is in your mind. Remember, the title of the story is The Summit Within. That means the summit which is within us is also as difficult to climb as the summits which are around us. Okay, so the mental summit he is talking about. It is in your own mind. Each man carries within himself his own mountain peak. You have your own mountain peak inside your brain, in your mind. And with your best effort, with the best mental strength, you can understand the true ability that you have and the true limits of your mind. Okay. He must climb it to reach to a fuller knowledge of himself, what a person is capable of, what a person can do, what are the strengths of a person. Everything can be understood if we have a full knowledge of our mind. So our life is more or less passed in looking out for that. Okay, we should spend it for that. What is our capability? And in order to find out what we truly are, we have to climb the summit within ourselves. It cannot be climbed by anyone else. But this summit, nobody can help you. You have to do it yourself. You yourself have to do it. The physical act of climbing to the summit of a mountain outside is akin to the act of climbing the mountain akin. The effects of both the climbs are the same. Whether the mountain you climb is physical or emotional and spiritual, the climb will certainly change you. It teaches you about the world and about yourself. Whatever climb you're taking, whether it is on top of a mountain or whether you're trying to climb on the summit within, if you are trying to find out what is there inside you or you are trying to get a better knowledge of yourself, both these things will change you emotionally and spiritually. It teaches you about the world and about yourself. Okay, so both these climbs will change us emotionally as well as spiritually, and it gives us a better knowledge about ourselves as well as our relation to the entire world. I venture to think that my experience as an Everester has provided me with the inspiration to face life's ordeals resolutely. That means with determination. My experience of climbing the mountain Everest has made me much more determined, much more physically, not physically only, mentally strong to face whatever challenges life throws at me. Climbing the mountain was a worthwhile experience. The conquest of the internal summit is equally worthwhile. The internal summits are perhaps higher than Everest. So he ends on a very lovely philosophical note, he also inspires us to pick on this difficult task of understanding the summits within ourselves. And because climbing both the summits are equally challenging, he urges us to do it, because then only we can find a lot of mental fulfillment. Okay, so here we come to an end of this chapter. We will discuss the question answers in our class. Okay, thank you, students.